You saw it on Sunday. It was episode 200. This is episode 201. Before we get into probably what a lot of you are going to salivate at, our pain, I wouldn't be remiss if we didn't mention this. Last week, it was obviously Mike Leach. Today, it was Franco Harris. It's just a lot of people, I don't think, realize, like, the newer generation of football fan, how much of a pioneer he was for the game of football.
Yeah, I mean, I think that entire – that entire Steelers run is kind of forgotten about in, you know, throughout the, in modern times, you know, over the years. It's just been like, you know, when people talk about dynasties, obviously they may mention Steel Curtain and all that, but I don't think the individual players ever get as much individual pop as they should. You think guys like Lynn Swan, obviously Franco Harris and guys of that sort, they kind of just get lost in all of it. Especially being an offensive player and on a team that is known for their defense. So, you know, yeah, that's tough, especially because they were going to retire his jersey on Sunday. We're like 3 days out from that. It's almost Christmas. You know, it was a lot. There was going to be a lot of Franco Harris in the news anyway. It just sucks that, you know, it got accelerated the way it did.
Yeah, exactly. That's the one big thing, too, where it's like, you know, and also that's one thing I learned, too. The Steelers don't retire a lot of numbers, which is something that'd be surprising. Yeah. But then everyone says if they retired all these numbers, there'd be no more new numbers for people to wear. So
absolutely, I feel like absolutely.
There's certain numbers they should retire. Like, I feel like 43-7 will be in that category very soon.
Yeah.
And I know it's the same thing with Ben, too. A lot of people like say, oh, but Ben, towards the latter half of his career, he wasn't that good. No, but yeah, in his prime, he was one of the best quarterbacks in the league by far.
And I know a lot of people, you know, talk about Ben as, like, you know, for the off-the-field stuff. And, sure, he was an absolute creep. But I think when talking about, like, football historically, we have to just take what happened on the field. And there was a stretch there where, like, Ben Roethlisberger was one of the best quarterbacks in the league. And it was a much longer stretch than I think people give it credit for. I know the last 2.5 years weren't very good, but you think back even to what year was that? 2017. He had a really good season. He took them to the playoffs. They played in the AFC Championship that game and that year. And, you know, things kind of went the way they went. But all the same, it's, you know, that was, no, I think it was 2016 I'm thinking of. But all the same, that was like a good year. That was a really good year. Kind of reminds me of that Aaron Rodgers quote, you know, the one, the my down year, some quarterback's best years, whatever. I think Ben Roethlisberger, while not obviously not that high, his years where people were like, he's kind of okay in the middle there. I mean, some quarterbacks dream of that. I think he had the misfortune of playing in an era with, you know, obviously Tom Brady, Peyton Manning. And so he's compared to those kind of players, and he was like a notch below them, but he was still a very good quarterback.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And the moral of the story, more or less, here is just that, like you said before, there's an icon of the game that's gone, someone who had one of the greatest plays in history. The Saturday is going to be cool regardless. I don't know if you saw this as well, but the Steelers are going to be wearing, like, the throwback block number jerseys from, like, the 70s and stuff like that as well.
I didn't see that.
I just saw it today on, I think it was Instagram, that they just announced that. So
I love it.
Throughout that, it's cool to see. It's just, it very much sucks that this weekend was about him, and that yesterday he was doing all these interviews and stuff, and then out of nowhere, yeah, he's gone. So that's the thing during this holiday season. Just hold the ones that you're closest with and just know that don't take every day for granted. But anyway,
absolutely.
Let's roll the intro.
I am having a very bad day.
Stanford band nowhere in sight.
Uh-oh.
It's picked off.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no.
Unbelievable.
Oh, wow. Incredible. Chandler Jones takes it in and wins the game for the Raiders.
I am in no mood. This today is one of the worst days that I've had in a long time.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great intro, though. You can't be mad at that. That's a good intro.
I am to please, because literally that's more than the what happened of the game Sunday. Yeah, it's, I don't know what to put it. Like, that was, there was demoral, there's, like, been heartbreaking losses.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's rare that the Patriots have had a demoralizing loss.
Right.
This was demoralizing because, and but we called this a month ago that we were going to – I called this, so that's why, like, it doesn't take away the sting. I just remember telling you we were going to beat Arizona, which we did, even yeah, under the circumstances, and then we were going to lose to Vegas. It's just the yeah, way it had happened. That's and more than anything the way I look at it.
Because I just didn't believe in Vegas. I still don't. I think it's what's going to get lost in all of it, obviously, and rightfully so. I think the Patriots deserved what they got. But what's lost in it is that the Patriots rattled off 21 straight points before the touchdown that wasn't a touchdown. And then, you know, that mess. But the Raiders started raidering, and the Patriots decided to out-raid the Raiders. And I'm like, cool, love that. Love that for us. Happy to be here. Like, ridiculous.
Yeah, exactly. Because that's like, if we had lost, like, say, 17 to 10 or 17 to they went for two. So it was like, say, it was like 17 to 9 even.
Yeah.
Look, fine. It is what it is. Like, you know, they were the better team. It's just the fact that they came back. Matt Collins catches the fourth down, and then there's the touchdown that wasn't a touchdown, which the officiating rabbit hole is something we can go down all along. I fully believe that they should hire them, these guys full time, but that's neither here nor there. It's just the simple fact that we had the game, it was going to overtime, but then the players went rogue. I don't like blaming the coaching staff for that. I understand them. They were just trying to, you know, you were trying to make a moment great, and it backfired. That's literally what happened. And the other thing I'll say this too, for everyone saying like, oh, Mac could have done this. Mac Jones, 10 times out of 10, is not tackling Chandler Jones on that play. I'm sorry.
Like, that's come just, on, that's let's not... be serious. Let's be serious. Yeah, that's – there's just so much about the final sequence of the game that just burns me up. But that play in particular kills me because everyone's like, well, you know, why didn't Mac make that tackle? And I'm like, I didn't realize how huge Chandler Jones is until he put Mac in the dirt. And you're looking, you're like, hey, Mac's never going to tackle that guy. Look at his legs. Are you kidding me? And he caught it in stride. He turned and he hit him. And it was like, all right, cool. I'm so curious as to what was going through Jacoby's mind. I know he explained it. He said, you know, he saw Mac and he wanted to make a play. But I think the question that needs to be asked is, and then what? Like, say you did complete it to Mac. You know, you threw the ball, you know, 15 yards behind you to Mac. And he was open, sure. Did you think he was going to, like, rumble down the sideline for 55 yards? Like, help me understand what you were seeing there. You know what I mean? But I completely agree when you say that the coaching staff bears no responsibility for that play in particular. I think it's really lazy to kind of blame them for that because it's not like it was a called play. And everyone's a genius in hindsight. So everyone's like, oh, they should have just taken the knee. They should have just taken the knee. But we've seen throughout the entire season, the Patriots have been super conservative. They've taken the knee and everyone's, you know, blasted them on Twitter for taking the knee and not being aggressive and going for the win or whatever the case is there. Patriots got the ball back with what, like 34 seconds or something to that effect. Two timeouts. They said, fuck it. We'll try to make something happen. I think it's kind of foolish to say like, oh, just take the knee because realistically we would have all been very upset with that. Like, fuck it. Win it in regulation. Don't bother with overtime. Just go out and win it. And Ramondre pitched that ball back to Myers, and Myers just threw a dime to Chandler Jones, unfortunately. So,
yeah, because that's even the other thing, too. Because, like, say, for example, Chandler Jones drops that, it's like, okay, then, like, it's like one of those things where it's like, oh, day disaster averted. But the same thing, too, you don't know what's going to happen in overtime. That's where the what if aspect of football always comes into play. But I hate it for that specific reason because when you get the what if aspect, it's like, oh, they could have done this, or they could have done that, or what if this happened, or if that happened. At the end of the day, it's a game. It's hard to move on. Luckily, the Colts happened too, so it wasn't like all the thunder rage. There was the Colts game too Saturday.
Yeah. But you know, the thing is, as weird as it is, like it was, as soon as the play happened, I tweeted out LMAO because like it was really funny in a way because like this is a team that we talked about it. Every time we've done a show together, we've kind of talked about, like, the team's like, they're kind of middling. They're really not that good. Their team's really not really going anywhere. And it was just kind of funny to just watch it happen because these are the kind of things that happen to other teams and we laugh about it. I think it would be incredibly hypocritical if I was like, oh, no, that's not funny. I saw someone compare it to the butt fumble. And there were Patriots fans in the comments who were really upset with that. I don't know. I thought it was kind of funny. Like, sure, like, it's one of those, like, really stupid plays. And when teams make really stupid plays, it's okay to laugh at them. I don't care if it's my team or not. If my team's going to make a stupid play, I'm going to laugh at them. Because if they don't care about it, I don't care about it.
Yeah, that's the thing. At the end of the day, they're moving on to this weekend. And look, it is what it is. They played a game. That's all we can say. But at the end of the day, when you transition to the playoff hopes of it, I'm going to say this, and I've said this off the record a bit to some people, I prefer this rate to this team not make the playoffs then get to the wild card round and get cooked, kind of like what we saw last year with the Arizona Cardinals. Now, injuries aside, you don't really go anywhere. Meanwhile, this year, you fool around, you go 9-8. There's that little potential for next year. That's the other thing, too, for everyone saying, oh, this team sucks, this and that. I still say this, too, for anyone saying, like, get rid of Belichick. Belichick's the problem.
Yeah.
Like, 2020, this team is not a 7-win team if Belichick's the coach. This team's, like, probably maybe best case 5, because you can easily take away, I don't know, the Pittsburgh loss, and then let's throw one in there for maybe one of the Jet game losses. I'll just say that just to be fun, not the one in Foxborough, because obviously we discovered that we have him on our roster. Yeah. but that's just my take on the playoffs where, hey, we'll talk about Saturday in a bit, but that's the way I look at it. I'd rather see them miss at this point than get in and give us false hope.
Yeah, I'm not I don't agree. Well, I don't hold the same opinion. I can understand where you're coming from with that. I have a Patriots group chat that I'm part of, and one of my good guys, Jude, is in there, and he's like, he's, you know, a really smart football mind. He really understands the game. He's kind of on the same page with you. Like, the team's better off missing the playoffs, get yourself in better position to kind of restock the roster. And I understand that. I just personally, I don't necessarily agree with taking the season away. I think that they may miss the playoffs organically. They may not just not have the horses to get there. And if that happens, then it is what it is. But I don't think the idea of like losing on purpose or not, you know, or not trying as hard or whatever the case is there, only because I don't think tanking actually works in the NFL. I don't think any team is ever a draft away. You think about the teams that are picking in the top, you know, the upper half of the draft. You look at the names up there, and outside of the teams that obviously traded into those spots, those are teams that were in there last year and they were in there the year prior. You even think about teams like, I know for a lot of people, they're like, oh yeah, the Bengals did it. They went out, got Joe Burrow, and then they were so good. And I'm like, well, no, they went out, got Joe Burrow number one overall, and then the very next year they were picking number 5 overall. And I know that, you know, Burrow had torn his ACL, but they didn't have a great record prior to that anyway. So, like, it's not out of their own power. You know, like, that ACL injury set them back maybe 2.5-3 wins. You know, you think about teams like Miami, they go, oh, tank for Tua. Yeah, and then they were picking in the top again. Like, it's kind of cyclical. Teams like Jacksonville, obviously, Cleveland. These are the kind of teams that, I mean, come on, Cleveland picked number one back-to-back. You know what I mean? Everyone, I think, puts too much stock in the ability to just go out, draft a really good player, and then, like, you know, take it from there. But in truth, when you're picking that high in the draft, it's because you're not a very good team. So the idea that, oh, I'll just, you know, go out and get someone at, you know, where are the Patriots picking right now, 11? They're like, oh, if the Patriots lose a few more, they can maybe slide into the top 10. Yeah, you go out, you pick someone at 9. Chances are you're going to be picking in that same range, 9-15, yet again, because let's be real, no one is a player away. Everyone, you know, teams that end up in the top 10 are in the top 10 multiple times in a row. Even teams like Denver, everyone was like, oh, they're a quarterback away. And right now they're picking, I think, third. Or, I mean, pardon, Seattle's picking third for them. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, I don't know. I'm more just kind of like enjoy it now. And more importantly, when we look at the draft, when we talk about the draft in general, I think we sell it really short. There are 256 players picked in a draft in a normal year. I think reducing it to, oh, you can only get good players in the first, you know, the first 14 picks. I don't know. I think there are too many good players entering the league, and there are too many good players all around to just say like, hey, we have to get someone in that top, you know, top 10 or 11 for it to matter. Especially because the talent drop off in the first round of the draft, I mean, it's always like 12 deep. Like once you're beyond that, the guys are kind of more or less the same. Like there are a lot of, like the number of elite players in the draft is usually less than 10. So obviously not everyone's going to be able to pick 10. So personally, I just want to watch more Patriots football, even though this team is really hard to watch this year. If they make the playoffs, cool. If they don't make the playoffs, I don't know that I'm going to be necessarily upset about that. Going into the wild card and getting whacked, yeah, that would be unfortunate. Although the Bills loss wasn't, I don't know. I was a little weird about that Bills loss in the playoffs because, like, it was, again, it was another one of those games that was kind of funny to watch just because it was so bad. And then you were just looking at the state of the defense and you're like, yeah, like, they're just better than us. Like, yeah, all right, cool. Like, took some edibles and I enjoyed the night. So.
So that was me with the Bills game too. Like by halftime, I'm like, you know what? You have 30 minutes left of Patriots football for 8 months, so just enjoy it. When I say my part about them missing the playoffs, I only say that because that's me being realistic. the fan in me, of course, I'd love to see this team run the table, go 10-7, have the Chargers lose to Nick Foles Monday night, which is another story all on its own.
Yeah.
But when and also too with the drafting thing as well, you nailed it on the head, because everyone that's like saying, it's like right now people saying the Bears. Oh, the Bears, if they can get Justin Fields this, they're like a world beater away and they're this crazy team. When in reality, they sold their two best defenders at the deadline. Robert Quinn, Roquan Smith, gone. Yep. For some reason, you gave up a second for Chase Claypool, which doesn't make sense to me at all.
Yeah.
So you nailed that on the head. I'm just coming at it from the perspective of, if they can land a pick like where they were 2 years ago, you know what, mid-teens,
yeah, like
that's yep. where I'm looking.
Sure,
more than
sure, yeah.
I'm not trying to creep into the top 10. God, no, I don't want this team to go 7-10. They go 8-9 or 9-8 down the stretch. It sucks.
Okay,
I'm yep. It's A-OK with
Completely.
Me. If they win eight to 10 win range, yep. I'm okay with it. When I say what I said before, it's more or less just me looking at it from a realistic perspective. But even, hey, you know what, maybe they sneak in. Maybe they win a game, make it to the divisional round. That's me saying that on the wildest dreams where everything, all the cards
yeah.
play right, you getting blackjack three hands in a row at a casino
yeah.
table. That's that dream. That's because
yeah.
that going into the season, that was like the everything goes right is you win a wild card game and then you're basically the 2020 Cleveland Browns, you know? That's where
yeah.
I see that. But when I see it with this year, like you said, I look at it as, hey, you know what, get in. Even if you get embarrassed, it's a hey, they made the playoffs. This
yep.
bad. This team was a little fluky, you know. Somehow made it in. I know there's a whole 20-point thing, but I think that's just bad. There's bad luck because there's a lot of those games where they let up more than 20. You can argue Baltimore, Green Bay, Minnesota, and even Sunday. So 4 of their 7 losses
yeah.
were games where they weren't horrible. The only games I could say where things didn't go right, it's like the one I always say, the Chicago game. If everyone's saying, "Oh,
yep.
this quarterback," no one played good that night. Buffalo, we learned that night, hey, the Bills are just the better team. And the other one, Miami, was just a bad game, too, considering.
Yeah, they scored 7 points and had nothing going on.
Yeah, they had nothing going
yeah.
on. So that's the thing you have to accept as a football fan. Not every week is going to go your way. Even we learned
yeah.
that even when the Patriots were the elite of the elite. Now with the playoffs, like I say, you're a team that's in the hunt at this time of the year. I think that the 6-8 teams, like the Raiders and the Jags,
yeah.
I don't see it there. It's like people trying to make plays to get Aaron Rodgers in the playoffs. I'm sorry, but if you're not at 7 wins going into week 16,
it's time to pack it up.
It's time
yeah.
to pack it up. It's that.
Yeah. Sure.
It's that. It's like I've seen some Raider fans being like, "Oh, we can run the table and get in," but I'm like, "That's when you're setting yourself up for heartbreak." You know.
Yep.
That's why
yeah.
you have to put on the realistic hat, because then you're not setting yourself up for disappointment. So say if the Patriots go 8-9, miss. It's not disappointing because it's like, hey, you know what? We've come to grips with what to expect. But if they
yeah.
run the table to get it in, it's just like putting the cherry on top of the sundae. So that's where I was trying to get at with that.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I would agree with that. I think, in truth, this is a bad Patriots team.
Yeah.
But it's always kind of fun to see a bad team get into the playoffs just to see if they can do a little something with it. I don't think this is the team for that. I think there are going to be big changes in the offseason, and that's why I've kind of resigned myself to being like, oh, well, I'm just here to watch the games, because I know that next year will be completely different. I know that come, you know, whenever Black Monday is this year, I think it's like the second week of January, once that rolls around, there are going to be a lot of changes, and this is not going to be the same team I'm watching forward, going forward. I know people want to make it about, you know, Mac Jones or Bailey Zappi, who's the quarterback or whatever. I think there are real issues with this team that go beyond that, and I'm just tired of people reducing it to just quarterback, because I think even if you swap out the quarterbacks, that doesn't fix the offensive line issues, it doesn't fix the offensive scheme issues. It's just not a super great team.
That's the thing. It's just not a great team. Like, we know this offseason, hey, there's going to be changes. There's also one person who's been very quiet that I think you're going to hear a lot from once the season is over. But Kraft, by the way.
Gotcha.
Like, yeah.
What are we talking about? Okay.
Yeah. But Kraft. But when you look ahead to this offseason, Miguel Bazan, you know, Pat's cap, obviously, he's great with the numbers and everything
yeah.
like that. He labeled out 8 ways to create cap space. And the first 2, I think, I agree upon strongly. And that is to extend Hunter and extend Judon. You know what? Take some money, have them give some money back now, and then push it down the road. So that when the cap keeps increasing, the number is fine. And also, too, I already have that, like, PTSD fear that they're going to let Judon walk for a huge bag. But I think he's a guy that you keep because he's a great locker room presence. Plus, too, he's a one-hell
yeah.
football player. Hunter Henry is the other one, because I know you and I have the argument of, like, not the argument, but we've basically come in here and said, you put him in a blocking scheme, he's going to be on his ass. You let him get open in the flat, guess what's going to happen? He's going to make plays. That's why I tweet out every game, when you get Hunter Henry the ball, good things happen, unless your name's Alex Kemp. the other three, which two I can see happening, but one I think will stay, is to either trade or cut Parker, Mills, and Bourne. I want to keep Kendrick to give him to his full potential, but I still think I just think of a way where he's a cap casualty because of the way he's been.
He's gone too.
Yeah.
He's just not really he's not playing great. I know that everyone's always like, oh, what about his usage? What about his usage? He's playing like 40 snaps a game. There have been times he's played 40 snaps a game. He's right around about, I think, 31 and a half per game. He's just not really producing. I think it is a scheme issue with regards to his, lack of production, but I don't think he necessarily fits what they're trying to do this year. I'm just questioning if that matters because, like I said, I think the offensive system gets an overhaul next year. So I don't know. Maybe he sticks around. I don't think six. I think his cap hit's like 6.9. I don't think that's that big a number that you have to be like, oh yeah, he has to go. So I don't know. But I think personally, he's gone by his request.
Yeah, I think he'll request to be cut, and then he'll benefit from a change of scenery. It's kind of like what happened to Chase Winovich last year. And I also think, too, they're going to try to get Tyquan an extended role in his second year now that he's going to have a healthy offseason to get adjusted to the offensive system. And then Mills, I think, stays. I don't think they're going to trade or cut him. I think he's just been bit by the injury bug.
Yeah, I think he's just so solid. He's not very good. He's not very bad. You know what you're getting out of him. You're getting, C-plus play. And I think every team kind of needs that. You could move on from him and just kind of elevate – Jack Jones is that full-time starting role, but there are some issues with that as well. So I think you keep Jalen Mills, especially if Devin McCourty goes, because I think you can move Mills back to safety and kind of make it happen there, but we'll see.
And with that one, I think that's a retirement more than he goes somewhere else. I think he's like
certainly.
Yeah, that's him and Slater. Those are retirements. Those are, I don't think those are there. Maybe he goes joins his brother on Good Morning Football. Who knows?
That would be fun.
That's not an insult, by the way. Jason's fantastic on that show.
Yeah, he's been very good. I think right now he's carrying the show because I used to like Kyle Brandt a lot. He's gotten on my nerves. I don't know why recently. And Peter Schrager has always been kind of, Peter Schrager.
I've always liked Schrager. Brandt, I don't know why, but I just don't like how all of a sudden I think it's a bit of the rivalry, but I don't like how you see him, Mike Robb being these huge Buffalo fans, but then you never really saw much of the media being like that when the Patriots were elite. But then all of a sudden Buffalo Bills are good, and then everyone all of a sudden, all these media people are out here publicly supporting Buffalo. That's just something okay, where was that when we were on top? And then the other one, which I think is realistic, is I don't think a trade, but I think a June 1st cut is due for Jonnu, just so the dead cap number is not as great and he gets another change. But my only question for that is then who gets tight end two? So I can see it happening, but I wouldn't be shocked if Jonnu's back on the roster in 23.
Yeah, I have an opposite thing. I think John is saying, I think Hunter Henry is actually going to be the one who's gone. They keep trying to make it happen with Hunter Henry this year, but he's just not playing very well physically. We talked about his usage in the run game. He's just not been that same kind of reliable, over the middle kind of threat. And he's not playing as well physically. I think John is kind of here just by virtue of his cap hit. But I also like when they get Jonnu the ball, because when they throw him the football in, down the field, he makes it happen. It's just he doesn't get as many targets as Hunter Henry. I think Hunter Henry's, target to impact ratio just isn't where it needs to be. I know he's been catching those seam balls, but lately it feels like he either catches the seam ball or he has nothing going on. And that's been super frustrating to see. I don't think you can go into the next season with both of those tight ends just because, they're really not doing much. But by virtue of the fact that Hunter Henry's entering his last year and his cap hit is what his cap hit is versus John, who has 2 years left on his deal, and he has a huge cap hit, which you can't move without, a June 1 cut or a trade, I think it's more likely than anything that Hunter Henry's the one who's gone. That's just my thought there. If they're looking to shed cap, I think, though, the entire question and this isn't about Miguel or anything. I think he's just answering the questions that people ask him. But I think the entire question might actually just be moot because the Patriots aren't hurting for cap space. So any player that gets moved, I don't think it's necessarily – I think it'll be framed as the player's a cap casualty and they're going to go. But in truth, I think across the league, teams just kind of hide behind the whole cap casualty thing anyway, because there are teams that don't need to free up the money who move on from players anyway. Like I said, Kendrick Bourne's cap hit is 6.9 or something, or thereabouts. It's less than $7 million. That's not like a significant number of that's not a significant cap figure. So sure, you can keep him, you can move him on, you can move on from him and say, oh yeah, we just freed up all this money, but you don't need to. So you would only be doing it because you don't value what he's bringing to the team. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. I don't think they necessarily need to make cap space, because they have, I think Miguel has him at somewhere around $38 million. Spot Track has him over at 51. I think that number's really high. I don't know how they got that big a number, but I'm going with Miguel's numbers because his numbers are always, he can always explain how we got to where we got to. So
yeah, exactly. That's the thing I just saw in the original tweet too, where he was saying that between 37 to 42. So it's not like they have to make a crazy big adjustment, but then there's also players to sign. There's some players who I think are going to walk, like Aguilar and Harris. I think both are gone. I think
absolutely,
it's a foregone conclusion. Aguilar's performance, and Harris is just, look, you got a horse at running back, and look, the kids are okay. The kids are all right. What the kids did against Arizona shows that, hey, these two guys are reliable, and that you can use Ramondre as a dual threat, and that you can use Harrison Strong for run game down deep. I also thought Harris's writing was on the wall ironically, Harrison Strong were drafted in 2022. So that's the way I look at that, where I think Damian Harris is – he needs a change of scenery, and I think his thigh injury is really not helping him either, to where it's
– yeah.
Yeah, because I'm pretty sure he was
somewhere down next year.
Yeah.
And just be a house. I'm personally looking forward to that. I kind of hope he lands in, like, Philly and just, like, does what he does. I think he's an excellent player. I just don't think he makes sense to resign because you have Ramondre Stevenson, who's a bigger factor in the passing game. Also, I think Ramondre is, like – just a better player, which is shocking because, like, last year, a lot of people got on that really early. They're like, oh, Ramondre Stevenson's the better player. And I'm like, nah, it's Damian. And lo and behold, it turns out Ramondre is actually looking like the better guy. And you're like, oh, cool. So I don't think it makes sense to re-sign him. And I think Kevin Harris has shown, you know, he's shown enough that it's worth developing. And I think Pierre Strong is good. Like, I think he's good right now. I know he hasn't got many opportunities, but I think you can see it when he runs, you're just like, okay, cool. I see why they drafted him in the fourth round, and I see what his role is going to be going forward.
It's like you understand why they took a chance on him. Because that's even the other thing, too, with the draft I want to point out, even though, look, Cam McGrone is someone I was really excited to see, but we're not going to see him in New England. Maybe next year. Maybe come back. Who knows? But when you look at the draft, I always say this. You can hit on day one. That's fine. You win the drafts in day two and day three. In the last 3 years – for all the flack Belichick gets for he's not able to draft, you can look at all three drafts and see solid contributors along the line. Kyle Duggar, great. Josh Uche, playing amazing right now. Even like guys like Nephry Jennings, and then you move into 2021, obviously Barmore, Stevenson. I'm really hoping to get to see Ronnie Perkins next year. That's one big hope that I have.
Yeah, I think the team have used him in the early middle portion of the season there where Uche was out. And they just had no one on the other side. I think Anthony Jennings is a good run player. I don't think he's a great pass rusher. And I think Ronnie Perkins can be a good pass rusher. So I was like, they really missed him. And then Uche turned it on. So now moot point. But, yeah, I completely agree. I think you look at even this past draft class, the only players who haven't contributed have been the two linemen.
And Stuber.
Yeah, the two linemen who were taken in the sixth round. Or seventh, you know what I mean?
And I think there's a chance that we see Stuber either in one of these three games down the stretch, especially because I don't think Wynn is gone. Because that's the other thing, too, where you look at this team for the future. There's only three offensive linemen that I think are 100% on this team next year. That's Andrews, and that's Strange, and that's Owen. Those three.
Yep.
So if you're guards,
your
centers,
three best players. Yeah.
Your three best players. Trent, I could see either taking a cheap deal, or I think he can come back just because of the price tag. I think, you know what, he'll be willing to take a discount. Like, you know what David Andrews did last year where – he went out, he explored the waters, but then, hey, the grass isn't always greener on the other side. So then you take route one, you go back to Bill's office, and then you sign another cheap 1-2 year deal or 1 year deal with a second year option. And then when I think is gone, I think it's just like a foregone conclusion. Someone's going to give him money. He's going to get one of those like Jamie Collins like contracts that you regret.
Yeah.
Someone's going to take a chance on him.
I think I've always been way higher on Wynn than most people. Like, he's been fine. I just think his errors have been like
more his price point compared to his like
absolute
his performance.
At that part, absolutely. Someone's going to pay him a huge amount, and they're going to have to because everyone needs tackles. There just aren't enough good ones. Like, in a 32-team league, there are, like, 18 good tackles. So someone is going to pay for win. It just sucks that the Patriots are essentially going to have to restart. Is Trent on his, in a contract year, or does he have another year left?
I think he signed. Like, I'll look it up, but I'm pretty sure right now he's on, like, a one-year deal. I'm, like, 90% sure of that. I just know that he came – he was one of the early pieces to come back for when the trade – for when the 21 offseason started. We're like, all right, cool, bring back Trent Brown. Oh, never mind. He's a two-year contract, so he's got one more year left. My apologies.
Okay. Do we know the numbers on that second year? Because I think if the numbers are crazy, he might be gone anyway.
So the contract was 2 years at $13 million, so it's about $6.5 million per, I guess.
Oh, that's pretty good. Yeah.
But I'll have to look at the I'll look at the sport track numbers just to see.
Okay. Yeah, I Trent hasn't been playing well. I know that, you know, he got sick and he lost all that weight and all that, but prior to that he hadn't really been playing all that well either. I think honestly, one of the biggest errors made this offseason, outside of bringing in Matt Patricia to coordinate offense, was really flipping Isaiah Wynn and Trent Brown, because even though people, you know, are down on Wynn and, oh, Wynn sucks, he had at least been serviceable at left tackle for the better part of 3 years, or 2.5 years really, because he missed that year. He'd been like a serviceable left tackle. You're like, all right, cool, he's gonna, you know, probably give up 4 sacks in a year. He's going to have a bunch of penalties, because that's kind of what he does. But he's going to be like, he's not going to get you killed. Then they move him to the right side, and he's been an absolute liability. And then Trent moving back to the left side was supposed to be like, all right, don't worry, our left side is, you know, handled. And then he's been getting the old, you know, the old razzle-dazzle over there. So I think that was just an error. And, you know, the Patriots don't like moving around their offensive linemen at this point. But I don't know, that was a strange decision. I don't think anyone benefited from it. Obviously, Wynn was really ornery about that. He's obviously entering a contract year, playing a new position he had never played, and he played poorly. So I think he's going to be gone. I think someone's going to pay him, you know, left tackle money to go, you know, protect the blind side for him, and he's going to be decent, not great, and that's it. And the Patriots are just going to have to find a new tackle.
So Trent's numbers, by the way, his signing bonus is $2.5 million. He only got $4 million guaranteed at signing, so it is a very good contract to keep around.
That's a good number, yeah.
Yeah, one player as soon as I saw the tackles to replace with, like, the name Orlando Brown came up, and I'm like, they're not in the price range. Yeah. You could potentially go the Jack Conklin route, but I think it's the same thing, not in the price range. So I could see them drafting. There's the one tackle from Northwestern, Peter Skorinski, I really like, but I doubt he makes it out of the top 10. Yeah. So it's a big wait and see, like, because when I look at this team for draft needs, it's more or less just restocking the cabinet. It's not like there's no glaring need, you know. Maybe obviously like wide receiver or a tackle, but besides that, I look at wide receiver to where I like your Hunter Henry going, because someone needs to come back in exchange for DeAndre Hopkins becoming a New England Patriot next year.
So here's the thing with that. I think I don't know if the Patriots will draft a receiver in the top or in the top few rounds of the draft unless someone sick falls. I think Zay Flowers is a good option out of Boston College.
Yeah.
I think he'll be there wherever the Patriots pick, because he, for whatever reason, he's not getting the hype he should get as far as like being a top of the first half kind of prospect. I think Zay Flowers is a good option, but I really think we're reaching the point where the Patriots are just going to swing a trade for somebody. I've mentioned Michael Thomas in the past online, mainly whenever I tweet these things are like, oh, this player's going to be a Patriot next year or whatever. It's mostly jokes, but I do honestly believe the Patriots do swing a trade for a receiver at this point. I think they have Tyquan Thornton there. There's some good things. He's doing some good things. He's getting open. He's not seeing the ball. He's really just been up and down the last few weeks. As far as like, there are some plays he's making and there are other plays he's just not really getting off of the press, and you're like, oh, that's kind of an issue. But I don't think you necessarily restart and go get another one, and you need, you know, and have two young receivers trying to work through them at the same time. So I think you swing your trade for a veteran. I think Michael Thomas is probably done in New Orleans. I think DeAndre Hopkins is a popular name, especially after that clip surfaced after the Monday night game. That would be a lot of fun though. So I'm not going to lie, that'd be exciting. I think Jerry Jeudy, I think one of the Broncos receivers.
That's a name I've been high on. That's a name I've been high on. The other one is T. Higgins out of Cincinnati, because it's an A.J. Brown situation over again. Plus, they have a cheap owner, and you have two players who are going to get paid. That's the thing. Yeah. So there's going to be an odd man out, and it's going to be Higgins. The other, like I say Hopkins jokingly too, but I still think to get a true evaluation on Mac, you need to get him a stud wide receiver one.
I completely agree. Right now, they're kind of like bandaging everything, you know, as far as like the receiving core goes. And truth be told, I do like, and I've said this before, I do like the receiving core they have. I do think, though, they just need a dynamic piece. Right now, they have a lot of like good complementary players, but they're complementing each other and not like – You need to, you know, I hate the term wide receiver one. I hate, like, at this point, I'm so sick of reading it. But you do need, like, just a – we've seen the trend over the last few years in the NFL where, you know, third-year quarterbacks, they just get them a stud piece and everyone's just like, oh, shit, all of a sudden this player can play. I think that's going to help a lot with the evaluation of Mac Jones. As far as, like, the whole quarterback situation goes, if you – so I'm a Mac guy. Everyone knows that I'm a Mac guy. I have the Bama bias there, whatever. But if – I'm not so steeped into it that I couldn't be convinced to move on from Mac. Like, you know, it's not going to take a lot. People are making some valid cases, especially after he had the stinker of the game that he had on Sunday. But I will say this. If you think the Patriots need to move on from Mac Jones to get a more a higher upside quarterback, like go out and get, you know, CJ Stroud or whoever in the draft and, like, someone who, you know, can be – you know, a game changer, fine. If you're trying to convince me that the Patriots need to move on from Mac Jones to insert Bailey Zappi, we need to stop having the conversation, because, like, you got to upgrade. And at best, right now, the argument for Bailey Zappi over Mac Jones is, well, they were winning with Zappi. And I'm like, stop it. Like, if you're saying, hey, move on from Mac Jones, go get you a stud, fine. Go ahead, do that. If you're saying move on from him to replace him with his lesser version, I'm not buying it.
That's my take.
There we
on
go.
It. I was going to get to this at some point, because I know everyone's starting to say right now, start Zappi. The only reason I would do it is week 18, if Buffalo is benching their starters and Case Keenum's a quarterback and you want to see what Bailey Zappi has. But Bailey is what I thought he was. It's a Jared Stidham replacement, because we didn't have faith in Jared Stidham. That's all Bailey is. When his name gets called, if Matt goes down with injury, guess what? In the three games Mac missed, they went 2-1. Sure, they beat the Lions, who at the time hadn't figured it out yet, which, thank God, and the Cleveland Browns, who, you know, this year's a write-off for them. So he won games you're supposed to win. And he looked good in the games, but that's the other thing, too. He wasn't anything spectacular to where it's like, you know what, oh, you have to replace him with him.
Yeah.
The Monday night game, it was this and this. I think the Monday night game was a mix of, hey, Mac's not 100% yet, plus, look, whenever it's his old interception, that was just an amazing read by Jaquan Brisker on the interception of the Monday night game.
Yep.
But if you look at him after that, besides the first Jet game, Colts game, he looked great. The Jets second game, look, no one looked good in that game except for Marcus Jones. Yep. Minnesota, he played fine. Actually, like, really good against Minnesota. He played okay against Buffalo. Arizona, he did enough to get the job done, except I think that for that interception too was just, you know what, a mix of bad offensive line play. Connor McDermott's your right tackle. You can only do so much.
It was very similar to the one he had against the Jets, where Bryce Huff just got around whoever the hell was playing. I think it was Yanni Kajus at the time. He was playing right tackle. He got around and got his arm hit, and the ball got picked off. It was almost the exact same interception. You know, like, tough.
Yeah. And then Sunday was just, look, both quarterbacks seemed to play pretty bad considering their circumstances.
Yeah.
So that's where
they were having a mid off.
But also, yeah, exactly. They're having a mid off. And then with this, and then with this coming season, 2023, I look at it as, you know what? He doesn't have to make the playoffs. We just can't see a major regression out of him. I'm not looking for this, like, you know, Josh Allen, oh my God, out of nowhere, MVP candidate. I'm looking for, can he play consistent games without throwing risky passes? Can he make more throws? And can he throw only maybe two screens in the game that aren't on second or third down? So,
yeah, I think
that's more play calling than him.
Yes, I think it's so tough. And I had this conversation with someone who is a really big Zappy, you know, Zappy acolyte, if you will. He really believes in the message, and he's, like, not a Jones guy in any way. And we had this conversation, and it really, it to me, it's just so hard to put it all on Mac, to be like, oh, yeah, it's, you know, the offense is being held back because Mac Jones sucks. And it's like, cool. Every player on the team outside of Ramondre Stevenson and Mike Owen is having a bad year. It's having, like, a career worst year at that. You know what I mean? Like, it's just, and it's across the board. It's, you know, four of the five offensive linemen, even David Andrews, is consistent as he's been throughout his career. He's having a bad year. Hunter Henry's having a bad year. Nelson Aguilar, oh, he's kind of Nelson Aguilar, kind of does what he does. Devontae Parker, I mean, he's never been a world beater in the first place, but he's had better years than he's having right now. Kendrick Bourne is having a terrible year. And you're just looking, and it's like across the board, these guys are not having great years. It's tough for me to then say, well, of these 11 starters, you know, nine of them are just terrible versus, hey, it's the first year in a new system with a defensive coordinator, you know, moonlighting as an offensive coordinator. Maybe it's not the players. Maybe it's a little more than that, because it's just insane to me that we've seen such a steep regression from all of these players. And we're just supposed to just take it as fact that, oh, yeah, it's the players who are just now all of a sudden bad, when last year they were not all of a sudden bad. You know what I mean? You can argue, oh, well, maybe they weren't that good last year and they were being schemed up or whatever the case is. Fine. Even if you honestly truly believe that, which is nuts to me, even if you honestly truly believe that, how do you explain everyone having a bad year?
Yeah.
Outside of the fact that there's a defensive coordinator calling 23 screen passes in the middle of a fucking game.
That's,
you know,
that's,
it's just tough.
It.
Like it's so easy to just give a mulligan, because you're like, yeah, these guys are trying to make chicken soup out of chicken shit, and we're now blasting them for not having a great year. But, like, their offensive coordinator this time last year wasn't even employed. You know what I mean? He was a special advisor. He was just kind of floating around. The quarterback coach was a special teams coach who was also a wide receivers coach after never having coached wide receivers before. So, like, this is someone who called a fucking quarterback sneak on, like, second down in his own territory. It was just nuts. And it's like, these are the guys who were brought in to go ahead and, like, coordinate your offense with your second-year quarterback. And they came in and they decided, hey, we're going to install some new stuff and we're going to run a new system and here's what we're going to do. And everyone is having a bad year. It's almost like it's almost just – it's inconceivable that people are blaming the players for what looks like a huge coaching issue. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe I'm wrong. And I know there are people out there who are just like, no, the coaching's fine. We got to blame the players. Like Matt Chatham, who I really respect his analysis, but he's been on this like, oh, yeah, you know, it's the players. It's not the coaching. But, like, let's be real. Like, let's talk about what we're seeing. When we're looking at, you know, screen, swing screen, you know, wide receiver screen, screen, tunnel screens, the fucking double screen, which never works, but they keep calling it the fake the screen right, throw it to Ramondre left, and get blown up 4 yards in the backfield. When that's being run 4 or 5 times a game, I'm sorry, I'm gonna look at the coaching like, hey, what are y'all doing?
Yeah, and that's the other thing too. Like, when you look at coaching, like, I saw that thing say from 98.5 where it was like Belichick has to go. And I saw some Bills fans reveling in it, being like, oh, we broke them. No, Belichick is not the problem. And also, I don't like the whole comparing, you know, like, oh, is Brady better? Was it Brady that made Belichick or was it Belichick that made Brady? It's both of them worked together for 20 years, right? And one needed to move on from the other. And if you folks don't believe me, there's a book on my nightstand that's called The Dynasty by Jeff Benedict. I've preached it every time I have a Patriots person on, because you need to go read that book, because that book has all the dirty secrets that you want to know. Not the Seth Wickersham bullshit, but it's the what you need to know about what happened. And also, I'll say this too, for anyone out there saying Tom Brady coming back, that's no. That doesn't benefit anyone.
Yeah.
He makes his team a Super Bowl contender all of a sudden. No, it's going to be 2019 all over again.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. And someone else said it reeks of desperation, and I need to find out who that was and just pin that tweet, because that is I would completely agree with that. I think, one, you would be throwing out, you know, 2 years of development on Mac Jones, and if you don't believe in Mac Jones, fine, that is what it is. You would then be looking for a new quarterback, because you're not going to have a 46-year-old quarterback as the guy, right? You still need to plan for the fact that – and this is someone who already retired. You can't just, like, insert him in the office and be like, oh, we're all good. So you're saying, hey, we're going to start fresh at quarterback, bring back Tom Brady, and then go out and draft someone anyway. Cool. If you then go out and use a first-round pick on a stud quarterback, like everyone keeps saying, you still have to address the rest of the holes on the offense. You still need a tackle. You need maybe two tackles. You still need to figure out what you're doing at wide receiver as far as getting yourself a game changing talent there. All that still needs to be addressed. You still do need at least one cornerback. You still do need, you know, something opposite, you know, Uche and Judon. Uche is going to be entering his I think it's the last year of his deal. He'll be going into a contract year. Judon will have another year after that, but you don't have a third pass rusher. there are positions that need to be addressed in the draft, and I think punting on that and then just, you know, bringing in Tom Brady and then just kind of restarting kind of puts you in a bad spot there. I think it's a fun storyline. That's all that it is. It's just a fun storyline.
It's the want over need with drafting. Like, we've seen the Pittsburgh Steelers do it over the last couple of years. Like, they didn't need Najee Harris. They didn't need to go get Kenny Pickett.
Like, they didn't need Pat Freiermuth. Yeah.
Yeah. They didn't need all those players, even though, excuse me, there's another Penn State tight end who's going to be a free agent this year who plays in Miami, who I'd like in New England, but at the same time, too, I don't think it'll happen. Gesicki, by the way.
No. Yeah. I don't think he's a good enough blocker for what the Patriots are going to be asking him to do. If they stick with this run heavy approach.
Exactly. But when it comes to things like that, when you look at the Patriots, you have to look at it where, hey, we don't expect this team to be a Super Bowl contender. And I don't think any Patriot fan out there is saying that. No, what I want next year is a team to be in the position where, you know, the LA Chargers are in, where the Miami Dolphins are in, to be, instead of being 7-7 at this point, to be 8-6, to be 9-5, you know, to be in that territory. You win a couple games you're not supposed to, because that's the thing with the Patriots this year. None of their wins were really games. They didn't really steal any games this year. And last year, that's something that they did. Like, they went into LA on Halloween and they beat the Chargers. Shout out to Adrian Phillips.
2020, they did the same thing against the Ravens. They weren't supposed to win that game at all in that rainstorm, and they did. It's just, this team doesn't have that. They don't have that, like, hey, we got one that we weren't supposed to get. Every single one that they were supposed to lose, they lost. And they lost some that they weren't supposed to lose. They gave away a win, you know, as far as the Raiders game. They weren't supposed to lose that game, and they weren't supposed to lose to the Bears. So it's like you're giving away games as opposed to stealing games. And I you hit it right there. I think that's a great way to put it. You want the team to be able to steal some wins. Right now, what it feels like is every win is like a, you know, hang on to your hat kind of win. Like, all right, they won, but do I feel any better about them than last week? No, that sucks. You know what I mean? Like, and that's kind of how it's been this entire time. They play the good teams and the defense keeps them in it, but you never feel like they're going to win. You know what I'm saying? Like, they, like the Bills game, I think, was a perfect example. And I know the Bills are an elite team. They, you know, should be in the Super Bowl, or should have been in the Super Bowl. I don't think they will be anymore, but they had the potential heading into the season to be in the Super Bowl, and everyone had them as favorites and all that. But that was a game where the Patriots defense kept them in it. And at no point did you feel like they were going to win anyway, because, like, the offense just had nothing, absolutely nothing going on. And you're like, cool. Even the Arizona game, I know they won by multiple scores at that point, but even that game, you were just like, yeah, they won, but holy cow, they were just, what a struggle that was. You know what I mean? It took the Raekwon McMillan fumble recovery to get it to a point where you're like, okay, now the Patriots are going to win. They're going to win, and it's going to feel comfortable. But there were points in that game where you're like, this can turn on a hat. Like, this is tough. Raiders game was kind of the same thing. It took the Kyle Duggar pick six, and you were like, okay, now I can feel like the Patriots can do something, but the offense just isn't where it needs to be.
Yeah, that's the thing. Because if you had last year's offense with this year's defense, this is a team that's in the wild card mix right now. Like, they're not on the outside looking in. They are a wild card team, 100%. But like, even the Buffalo game still, like, it was just, you knew how good Buffalo was in that moment, because you're like, okay, Josh Allen's still doing goofy shit, but they only won by 14. Like, that's the thing. Like, Josh Allen had that one crazy throw, I think it was to Gabe Davis, where, you know, the one where he, like, went out of bounds and then he got it. And then
Yeah,
like, he had moments like that where you realize, okay, yeah, they're the better team. They are that. Like, Buffalo's no longer scared to come into Gillette and win. Josh is, since Brady left, he's won every game here. But when you, like, even last year too, going into Buffalo and beating him, I know everyone says, oh, but Mac only threw two times. That's the game where I look at saying, you do not win that game if you have Bill Belichick. That game, the windy, snowy game, the 2-for-3, 19 yards, Damian Harris had the crazy run. You don't win that game with Bill Belichick. Any other coach would have probably played a very conservative style of football. And that was conservative for Bill's metrics. Meanwhile, when I look at this team for this year, and I look at teams for Saturday, I'm just going to flash the graphic up, because, look, we are playing the Bengals. Fun fact, the Bengals haven't won in Foxborough since 1986. They're 7-0 in that stretch.
Hold on. Is Cincinnati -3.5?
Yes. Cincinnati's -3. Yes.
Holy cow. I think the Patriots get slaughtered in that game. The Vegas obviously disagrees. That's nuts.
I think they're I don't know what it is with this line. I think there's people thinking, and also, I looked at it right now, the public is heavy on the Bengals for this weekend. It's like 80% of the tickets coming in are Bengal bettors. So I look at this. I think there's two reasons why they think that this could be close. Because of the way that Davante Adams was defended on Sunday, can you do that to Jamar Chase?
Yeah.
But then again, I look at it, it's like, okay, but they have T. Higgins, they have Tyler Boyd, yep. they have Joe yep. Mixon. When we looked at James Conner ran on this team.
Yep.
And like you said, it was the Arizona win felt very good, but at the same time, too, we live too much in the moment. Because the way I look at this team, I could see a world where they win on Saturday, it's 8-7. And then next week in Miami, you know, next week Miami comes to town. It's just one of those things where, oh, nothing happens. Because the worst case scenario, I think, and what I don't want to happen is we're 9-7 going into Buffalo week 18. They crap down our throats and eliminate us from playoff contention. I would rather be out. That's my thing. I would rather have our
ahead of time.
I'd rather be out. I'd rather either be out ahead of time or we have a spot secured ahead of time, which the second one is doubtful. Like, the Chargers would have to lose their next two games to...
And then New York has to lose as well, which I actually think could happen.
New York does not have an easy schedule to finish the season.
Yeah.
That's the thing. Like, even... Because that's the thing, too, where for everyone saying, oh, the Patriots this with Mac Jones or this and this and this, the way I look at it with the Jets, it's the same thing. But guess what? You have the weapons. You have a consistent offense. The fact that they're 7-7... is still worse than our 7-7. I know people came at me because they're like, oh, but who have the Patriots done since that Jets game? I will stand by this take on this season that the Jets needed that game more in Foxborough than the Patriots needed.
I completely agree.
Because the Jets losing that game, look what it's done to them to where now I think if there's a still Robert Saleh, Mike White, Zach Wilson ownership controversy, when you start fighting with ownership, that's when coaches lose their job. So I'm not here to say Robert Saleh is going to get fired, but There's always a surprise on Black Monday.
That would be really Jets-like for them to do that because it would just be a bad decision. I think Robert Saleh is a great coach. That entire New York controversy is nuts to me because I don't think Mike White is very good. I don't. But I think he is significantly better than Zach Wilson. And I've never been a Zach Wilson believer. Like coming out of the draft, I was like, yeah, this is the guy who's going to bust. It was him and Trey Lance. I don't know about Trey Lance yet, but I remember I tweeted it. I was like, yeah, these are the two guys. Because it was like, oh, yeah, these five quarterbacks, Mac's going to be the one to bust. And I'm like, if we're being real, the ones who are most likely to just bust outright are going to be Zach Wilson and Trey Lance. So the fact that the issue with Zach Wilson right now is he's just not very good at quarterbacking. Like he just can't throw the ball. And the bigger issue, though, is that his team – is very much upset with him and his inability to throw the ball. So, like, the frustration, I know that, you know, there was a lot of talk on Sunday about, you know, Mac's frustration, but I think it's nuts that every time Zach Wilson misses a pass, there's a wide receiver grabbing his hair or, like, throwing his helmet, and I'm like, yeah, I know, this is frustrating. So I think there's a realistic chance they lose. I just don't know that the Chargers do. They're playing the Nick Foles Colts on Monday night? I think that's a W for them. But I don't really think LA is that good a team either. I think they have good players. I just don't think they're a very good team, though.
I think with LA, I could potentially see them losing in Pittsburgh just because they're that team like the Miami teams of the past. Like, you remember all those years when, like, New England would lose to Miami in December and then Miami has a game next week where it's, like, a must win and then they, like, lay an egg. I remember it happened after the Miracle in Miami. And then there was one, I think it was 2014 or 13. They beat us, and they're like, they got to go up to Buffalo and win, and they lost like 24-0 in the snow. So I can see a similar thing happening with the Colts, like where Nick Foles gets this like miraculous win on Monday night, and then next week everyone's like, oh, the Colts. It's like, you know how the Detroit Lions last year, which obviously the Detroit Lions now to what we thought at the beginning of the year, two different teams, but the Lions last year got some wins they weren't supposed to, and then everyone next year was, they're the team to watch, which they – was the right take. They just, we'll talk about them in a second. I think a very similar thing for there. And then you have teams like Arizona where it's just like, what do you do? That's the thing. Cause I don't like everyone using, I know, look, Kyler tore his ACL in that game. I don't want to use that as you only won because Kyler tore. I also don't think it's a very nice thing to say either. You only won because this happened. This might come off bad. You take advantage of your situations. You know what?
Sure.
Stuff happens.
Absolutely.
And that's what happens.
The sport. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, the sport happens. Any given Sunday,
Real quick on the Cardinals, I think they should just kind of move on from their front office folks. Just move on from Steve Keim. I know that whole, you know, he stepped down taking a hiatus or sabbatical or whatever.
I have a take on that, actually.
Oh, what is it?
I think they're giving him his flowers like what happened to Dave Gettleman last year.
Yeah.
I think he leaves and then it's, I've agreed that I'm stepping down to take care of my issues. I don't think it's health. I think there's something else to it. Like, I don't want to go speculating, but I wouldn't be shocked because I know we think he had a DUI a year or two ago. So I wouldn't be shocked if it was like alcoholism or drug abuse. Obviously, we're not hoping, but I just can see that happening. Yeah. But I think this is a way, and also too, because for anyone out there, Keim's been with the organization since 1999. He's been the GM for almost 10 years now. So I think it's just the way to, like, you know, let him leave with his dignity. And then with Cliff, I know everyone's saying, oh, Patriots OC. I think he does what Rule does. I think he goes back to college. I think someone will pay him a lot of money to coach their team, considering it's just that college desperation. And that's what I think
works best in college. I think his scheme works better in college when you can just have, like, the athletic edge.
Auburn.
That would be fun. What really kills me with the Cardinals is, like, their entire system is built on, like, oh, we are better than you, so, like, here's what we're going to dictate as an offense. And that just doesn't really work in the NFL because everyone is good, right? Even the bad players are still pretty good. So you can't just out-athlete everyone like he did in college. I think I completely agree with the whole Steve Keim thing. I think they're kind of doing him like Gary Kubiak in Denver where they're like, oh, yeah, you know, he's going to – you know, just going to work on some things here and then he's just going to disappear into the background. Really, a few teams have done that. And the only person we've ever seen come back from that was Howie Roseman in Philly, where during the Chip Kelly year, they were like, oh, yeah, he's going to work on some new things. And he disappeared. And then they brought him back and, he's working out great for them. But I think, he's out of here. Cliff Kingsbury is probably going to go as well.
Who's the guy that left Houston because his wife had cancer and then he... Who was their old GM before their whole shit show that just occurred? Who was it? Do you know what I'm talking about?
No, I don't remember who that was. Before Nick Caserio?
Before Caserio.
I do not remember who was GMing over there.
Like, this is during the, and I love to reference this, the Letterman jacket years, you know, where they thought it'd be cool to wear Letterman jackets into Gillette and you get your ass kicked by Tom Brady on primetime. I gotta look this up because it's killing me. Who is it? No.
Oh, while you look at that,
Rick Smith.
The person I was thinking of, Ted Thompson, did the same thing for him in Green Bay, where you know they kind of just let him off easy before they hired Brian Gutekunst, but they were like, oh yeah, you know he's gonna step down and he's gonna step down as GM, but he's still gonna work within the organization, and you've not heard a peep out of him since. So I think that's kind of what they're doing over with Steve Keim. As far as though that, like, you know, what happens, we were talking about the Lions being kind of risky and the Jets having the pieces. I think all of these teams have one huge advantage over the Patriots in that they have better players. And that's kind of what happens when you're picking high in the draft every year. You just end up with an accumulation of, like, good players. And those teams are starting to kind of put it together.
Every blind squirrel finds a nut.
Absolutely. I think what's interesting is, though, there have been a lot of debates about who has, you know, who's the worst offense, the Bucs or the Patriots. And everyone's like, oh, obviously the Patriots, obviously the Patriots. But I honestly think the Bucs may actually just be worse based on the fact that they have the talented players. So their year is infinitely more disappointing than, like, it's like, all right, cool. We had Mac Jones, Devontae Parker, and Nelson Aguilar. Those are your two wide receivers, and that's your quarterback versus Tom Brady, you know, Chris Godwin, and Mike Evans. That team being 6-8 is atrocious. Like, you can spin it however you want, but, like, one of these teams has a DC playing OC, and the other team has the greatest player to ever play the sport, two really good wide receivers, and a head coach and offensive coordinator who have been there. You know, not obviously in those same roles, but who have been there for the better part of four and a half years. So, yeah.
Yeah. Also, too, with Tom Brady, I'm going to say this right now. I don't want to see him go ring chasing. I think he either goes back to Tampa for a fourth season or he's done. I think. I think it's one of those two.
I don't want to see him suck. And it kind of feels like we're heading that way. I think he's been fine this year. But the elite play, like the, you know, elite upper level play isn't quite there consistently. So I don't want to see him start to suck. I don't want to see him end up, you know, on a bad, you know, bad Seahawks roster trying to make it happen over there. That's just not something I really want to see.
Exactly. I think, and then when he retires too, you know, he'll have his moment in Tampa. He'll have his, apart from the obvious gold jacket, he'll have his red jacket moment. He'll get a statue outside, maybe the new lighthouse that's under construction right now, which is starting to come along. I've been seeing some photos. That construction's looking really good. But that's my take on that. But when I also look, like, I was saying earlier, the person, when you come to change, when I was like, Bill Belichick can just take it overhead. Do you really think Robert Kraft's going to want to sign up for another year of mediocrity? Because that's the big thing. He's not going to let Bill go, but he's got to say, he's probably got to go to him after the season saying, Bill, we can't have this again. You got to go out there and get someone. So whether that's Robert at the Sugar Bowl, or if that's waiting for someone else, or even help, the Adam Gase name has come up a couple times. Yep. Everyone's saying, Adam Gase, but he sucks. Adam Gase worked pretty well with Peyton Manning in Denver, and also he was okay in Chicago. So if they were to do something like that, I'm not going to be pissed about it. It's basically at this point, look, anything's better than Matt Patricia when it comes to this offense.
I think that's a really good point that you say, Robert Kraft's going to go to him at the end of the season and tell him we can't have this again. I think that conversation may have already happened. We've already seen it kind of trickling out, you know, slowly that like, there are going to be some changes in the offseason, or, you know, is Kraft going to have a say or whatever the case is. I think that conversation may have already happened. I personally believe that the changes are coming. I'm just really curious as to who is up next. I think obviously Bill O'Brien's like the big name. Everyone's like, bring him in. And I would like to see that because obviously he was coordinating over in Alabama, and he has that familiarity with Mac, and he's a really good play designer. Even if he's not a great head coach, I think he's a really good offensive coordinator, so I think he can bring him in. A really rogue name, I'm just going to throw it out there, but I would like to see it personally. I think Chip Kelly would be a really interesting fit here, because even though, as long as they try to bring up the full-time hurry up like he did with Philly, and then like he did with that one year with San Francisco, I think he also has a really good knack for play designs. He gets really crafty with them. So I'd like to kind of see that. But I think in truth, we're going to end up with someone really random who's going to be perfectly fine at the job, but it's going to be someone that we're not thinking of right now. I think there are a lot of really hot names. I think this past year, though, a name that I had wanted, just really low key, I really wanted Kevin O'Connell before he landed in Minnesota. That was a name I was like, I want to see that happen. But obviously, he didn't. But I think it's going to be someone that isn't on everyone's radar right now.
Yeah, I agree with that. It's like, let that time come, let the time go, you know, where it's like, hey, someone's going to be brought on, someone's going to come do the job. I can see them going, because it's Belichick, to go completely left field, except for night one of the draft. Folks, 4 months from now, get mad when he does trade the night one pick when he trades back. But look, it is what it is. We're here for the ride. Even on Sunday, too, that's the worst part about Sunday's game, was that I had like a family Christmas thing going on. And so to go through that with people who aren't really football people around, that was the worst part. And the worst part, too, is someone coming downstairs being like, you're not a Bucs fan or anything like that. I'm like, nope. Because for years and years, I got the crap criticism of, are you going to jump ship? Are you you're only here for Tom. So you know what? I'm here and I'm still going to be here because you earn your stripes when the team's not good. That's the thing. Yeah, you earn your stripes. I know for you it's different. You're a Bostonian and everything like that.
Yeah, so regionally. Yeah, for sure.
But for someone like me, I earn my stripes as a fan right now. The good and bad thing is that I've been more in tune with these teams over the last 3 years because of this podcast platform, because I started it at the beginning of 2020, so, which kind of a good time for that. But with everything to do with that, I just feel like, you know what, I've been here. I don't want to jump ship, because it's really easy to do that. It is what it is. Before we go, there's a couple other things I want to get into. I was going to mention some bets. Two things. One, have you heard about what happened in Kansas City recently?
No, what happened in Kansas City?
Well, it's not in Kansas City, but a Kansas City Chiefs fan was on his way to the game in Houston.
Oh, my gosh. The dude with the robbing of the bank.
Him? The Chiefsaholic, yes.
Yeah, holy cow. That was a wild story. So someone said he robbed it in the fursuit. There's no way that's real, right?
I've seen, I got a look, because there is footage. I got a stupid fingers. Holic. Because there's images of the dude, like, where is it? So there's basically, here's this photo of him right here. This is him going there. Ignore the... And then there's photos of a dude. And then there's, like, it's a really grainy security camera photo. But then there's photos of this.
No way.
Of this dude robbing a bank in Bixby, Oklahoma. Where it's completely wild. Like, even here's another angle of it right there.
That's insane.
And this dude was going on about, like, apparently flexing about making large wagers on bets, buying expensive things, going on, like, these Patrick Mahomes charity galas that apparently cost a lot of money to get into. So I was thinking, a dedicated Chiefs fan. And people were concerned when he didn't show up. But no, it turns out right now he's being held in a county jail somewhere in Oklahoma on $200,000 bond. I even found the rap sheet for the guy. And, oh, my God, I got to look it up.
This is an insane story.
Yeah, it's just where is it? Oh, right here. Like, even a tweet from someone saying, "I guess you never really know what a person is like. Chiefsaholic letting Chiefs kingdom down. He won't be wearing that wolf costume for a long time. A different uniform now." But I'm pretty sure with the charges, it came along with, like, armed robbery, with, like, a costume and some other stuff. So he the idiot, on his way to the game in Houston Sunday, makes a pit stop in Oklahoma to go rob a bank.
I mean, hey, it was on his way, I guess. It was, you know, the GPS told him, hey, pull over here, rob the bank, and you're good. That's insane. What a story.
And speaking of what a story, have you seen the video of what happened at the Raiders game, Raiders-Patriots game Sunday?
I did see that. I did. That was frustrating.
I got to give a shout-out because they found him on Twitter. They found him on Twitter, at D-U-G-G-I-E, Dougie490. Yeah. That is the fan. His name is Jerry Edmond. He said he did not want to ruin his first NFL game experience. There have been multiple Raider fans to come out and say that we don't behave like that. Which, for the Raiders, who have a notorious, how do we put this in polite way, violent past for ways to come to interactions with fans.
Yeah.
Well, no, I'm just saying that because in Oakland, Oakland's been kind of known as a place where you do not go, you wouldn't go as a visiting fan. You've heard reports of, like, fights and, like,
I mean, they call the stadium the black hole for multiple reasons, like.
Exactly. Yeah. But it seems like ever since they moved to Vegas, that's cleaned up a lot. And I think that has to do with the fact that they expect, hey, a lot of away fans are going to come because you are in a tourist destination city. Absolutely. No offense to Oakland, California, but you're in Vegas. And there were thousands of Patriots fans at that game. And and that's the other thing, too, I want to say. When I was in Foxborough, I didn't see a single dumb incident go down. I saw hundreds of Lions fans. Not one thing was said. No one did anything. It was just everyone was there to enjoy the game. And so, look, that's how I take it with Boston fans. I've never seen a bad one. Every fan base has its bad eggs.
Oh, absolutely.
But for him, though, to not do anything, because in that moment, you just witnessed something horrible happen and someone's rubbing their face in it. That's something that could have gone very south very quickly. So, Jerry, just wanted to give you a quick shout out. And that's his first ever NFL game, too.
Yeah, that's a tough game, especially, I mean, just how it ended. So then, I mean, I'd already be pissed in the first place. To then have someone yelling, I mean, he's a better man than a lot of us, because I'm not going to lie. I wouldn't have hit, because I'm mostly nonviolent, but I would have had some words. I would have definitely gotten back in her face and all that, just because I know, like, emotionally what I was feeling on my couch on Sunday. I can only imagine being in the stadium with someone chirping in my ear like that. Ah, that's crazy. Jerry, you're a good man, because holy cow, you're better than me.
Exactly. And a quick little note I'm going to give here, folks, for this weekend. Obviously, usually I go over every game. We're not going to do that here because, obviously, of timing and everything. And I know McGarvin's not a big gambling guy. Fade these picks if you want, because my picks have sucked lately. And those are as follows. That's Seattle plus 9.5 because the Chiefs cannot cover at home. They're 3-10-1 against the spread all year. Also, I like the Saints at plus 3 against Cleveland. I trust their defensive shop with Sean Watson. And the other one that I like is Minnesota at minus 3.5. I think the Giants have a letdown spot after an emotional divisional win. I know the Vikings had the win they had, but But I think the way the Giants won, I could see them, you know, having a letdown game and then have that like pressure of like, oh, you have to win to get in. Because with the Vikings, they're pretty much in. They've solidified themselves. They got their hat and t-shirt. So I wouldn't be shocked here to see. I also can't see Daniel Jones doing it two games in a row where he goes in and just like wins the game on his own, even though shout out to Kayvon Thibodeau, who's going to be a stud in this league for many years to come.
He's very good. He is very good.
He is very good. But I just think that happens. I can see them see the Giants having a bit of a down day. And I said this, and I believe this more now. Bet the Steelers to win because of the Franco Harris stuff, because of the retro throwback, and because look, this is a game where this is a classic Raider letdown spot. You know,
absolutely.
They just got that crazy
win. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And this week it's all about Pittsburgh. I even saw something today where the Raiders released their side of it. I feel like the Raiders have been on the bad side of history so many times that for them, you know what? We'll let them have this moment in the sun where you had your one good moment. Sure. But if you look at like the immaculate reception, if you look at the Tuck rule, even though they say, I saw a bunch of stuff from them saying F the Tuck and everything like that. I'm like, you know what? Yeah. Hey, his arm was going forward.
It was an incomplete pass. No, he definitely fumbled that. The most surprising thing you just said, though, the Seahawks are +9. I know Kansas City is Kansas City, but they have not been they've not been a buzzsaw. They've not been cutting teams down. All their games have been significantly closer than they had any right to be. So I think the fact that they're -9 against the Seahawks is insane to me.
Yeah, I think it's just a lot of people thinking that like they're going to eventually figure it out and kick someone's ass.
But it's week 16.
Yeah, like, and they would have done it by – like their only big wins this year was the one San Francisco game. And then there was the one game against Arizona week one where they basically dominated. But then ever since CHE has been out, they've been relatively quiet. And the other thing I'll say about them, if you think that Kelsey's better than Gronk, no.
I agree. Yeah. I think Kelsey's very good. I do think, you know, he's a very good player. He's an elite player. He's not Gronk. Like let's be real. If you need to go back and rewatch Gronk, then go ahead and do that. But just stop it.
A recent game where that happened was 2017 against the aforementioned Pittsburgh Steelers. Go watch that game. And also, too, I've been seeing this guy on Twitter. I don't know if you've ever seen him. Scott something. He basically he's on the Pro Football Writers Association. He's from Pittsburgh. But basically all he'll do is you can tell he hates the Patriots because he comes up with like different ways of like, oh, like the Brady wouldn't have won these games if this had happened. And the one that he did that I wanted to point out.
Oh, Scott Kathmar?
Yeah, Scott Kathmar. Yeah,
oh.
Him.
Holy cow, that guy hates the Patriots. It's personal. I'm like, okay.
The one he said about, because it was the 2011 AFC Championship game, you know, the Lee Evans drop pass, and then he's like, oh, the Patriots won because Cundiff missed.
Yeah.
Cundiff makes that kick. The game goes into overtime, so we don't know what happens. Patriots, that's the thing. That wasn't a must-win game. That was like Sunday. You know what? Hey, they're down by three. Oh, actually, no, it's not like Sunday. They're down by three. I thought for sure, we're going overtime.
Yep.
He missed the field goal. I'm like, holy shit, we're going to the Super Bowl.
Yes, that was an exciting time.
That was.
Yeah.
But anyway, to you and yours, Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Christmas.
Absolutely.
This has been episode number 201. We got a lot off our chests. It's going to be this is going to be a big off. I hate to say this already because there are three games left, but this offseason,
The year is done.
This offseason is going to be a big one for the Patriots. We'll be here all offseason long, whether it's McGarvin, whether it's other people. Shout out newest Patriots guest reporter, Kyrie Thompson from WEEI, who was on.
He is phenomenal. Love him.
Go back and listen. He was on the day before the Bills and Patriots game. He came on. We chatted up for a bit. He had great insight, great reports.
Yep.
This is going to be an exciting offseason. Yes. Ignore all the crazy takes like the Felger takes.
Yep.
Pay attention to the people that are in the facility on a daily basis. That's what I want to say about that. Like the Mike Reeses, like the Zach Coxes, like the two guests who have been on here, whether it be Kyrie, whether it be Keegan Stiefel, those are the guys you want to follow for your offseason coverage. But anyway, folks, 201 in the bag. Next week, we're on to week 17. We're on to the college football playoff. It's going to be an exciting episode.
On to Cincinnati.
McGarvin and I, we're on to Cincinnati. Merry Christmas to everyone out there. Enjoy week 16. Because why? Because the regular season only has 3 weeks left.
We're almost there.